Slide down.
Okay. What's going on, folks? Ed Johnson here, nerd vlogging, you guys. And as you're listening to me on the podcast, I'm recording nerd. What's this? A slide down to stop. Tap to flip camera. There we go. What's going on? Demon. XXXXXXX Demon. Thanks for joining the show. What's going on? We're going to keep it short and sweet. I was just telling somebody how anal I am about alphabetation. It's not good sometimes. Sometimes it's just a hat rack. Alphabetizing and money and how anal I am about how certain things have to be. I don't know why I got onto that subject, but... Oh, I was alphabetizing the apps on my phone. It bothers the shit out of me when something's out of alignment. Anyway, not important. What is important are the comic books that we're reviewing this week. Now, I have to apologize because I mentioned comic books that I have not read yet that I'm going to get to. Let me just show you the covers of them. I have a lot of comic books. In a very short period of time, I've collected a lot of comic books. I have not bought comic books individually for a long time. What I tend to do is I buy trade paperbacks. But with the new DC Rebirth, I wanted to be up on it and talk about it. And I'm doing... Oh, that's not important. I'm just buying a few more things than I normally would have. But I still want to review this comic right here, Nighthawk number one by Marvel. I love this book. I love the character when they did the Squadron Supreme. And I've been out of the loop on what he's been doing since. But it's it started out as an alternative version of the Squadron Supreme. And this was a character who happened to be from the South. And his crimes actually focused on Caucasians because he's a racist black guy in wealthy vigilante. It's a little deeper than that, but that's the gist of it. This one I got last week. This is all new, all different Avengers. This is a pretty thick issue, and by Wade and Kubert. Have not read this yet, but looks beautiful. I'm looking forward to reading it. Just excited about reading that. But some older books that I mentioned that I haven't read yet, so I can't really review. Iron Man, the International Iron Man number 1 and 2. I'm weeks behind on this, and I think that new one comes out next week or the week following, but looking forward to reading this one for you and reviewing them. I apologize to you guys that I'm so behind on some of these books. You probably already read them. Don't really need me to review them. What else did I miss out on? I don't see the first issue of this, but this is the second issue of the Black Panther, and I have not read and or reviewed the first and second issues of that, and I will. Oh, and the new Ghostbusters. I just got this last week. Or this week, Wednesday. I got this week, and I haven't read that. But I love the arts. What's his name? I forget the artist's name. Blah, blah, blah. I follow him on DeviantArt quite a bit. Is it Otis? It's not Otis. Is it Otis? It looks a lot like that guy, Otis Frampton. The art is by Dan Scholing. But it looks a lot like another artist that I was thinking of. Big fan of that guy's art. And I bought this trade called The Parker Luck. Halfway through it. It's about when Peter first comes back after Otto Octavius had controlled his body for months on end. And just him and the ramifications of Otto taking over his body and what he did while he was away. He has a new enemy in the Black Cat because Otto put her away and revealed her all of her secrets to the world, who she was, and took all of her money, so she's pretty vindictive about that. Otto had started a relationship with this little person. They moved in together, Anna Marie, and she did not realize that Otto and Peter were two different people, and now she's realizing that Peter's back and Otto's out of the picture, so she's trying to cope with the fact that her lover's still there, but her lover doesn't love her anymore. Peter discovers this new girl, Silk. This is when Silk debuts. That's how far back the stories go. And they have this attraction to one another. Apparently, she's a girl that was at the school trip at the same time Peter was when Peter got bit by the spider and then she got bit by the spider. And then that guy, Ezekiel, that tried to get Peter and train him for Morlun, turned. I don't know how that story ended. I know that Ezekiel, I think, betrayed Peter or something along those lines. But he had kept this girl in a bunker for years, telling her that if she ever left, that her family would be in danger. So here she is with powers very similar to Peter's, and she's been in this bunker for, I think, like 10 to 16 years or something like that. So Peter just freed her because something had happened where everybody's secrets were revealed. I forget. I think it was part of that whole Watcher thing. I'm sorry. I don't buy comics as frequently as I used to, so I'm trying to catch up, or I try to catch up in trades and stuff like that. But during the last big Marvel crossover, everybody's secrets were revealed. Everybody was told, or were told, exactly what happened. And through those secrets, everything that people didn't know, like Thor and Captain America and blah blah blah, Peter found out that this girl Silk was being kept in this bunker. So he freed her. Blah blah blah. Anyway, that being said, let's review the books that I did read this week. And that would be Civil War 2. And this is more a zero, actually. This is the one prior to, I guess, the big crossover. And it's written by Brian Michael Bendis. I don't know how this guy puts out so many books at one time. And all of them aren't hacky. You know, I mean, there are some writers out there that are pretty hacky. And Bendis, I don't know, he captures the human spirit. In normal conversation, I've been a fan of his quite a bit, long time, since reading Powers way back, and all of his stuff that he's done with Marvel has been solid. And in here, the one thing that I do want to say about Marvel before we go further is that I am annoyed that they keep fighting one another in these civil wars. I don't mind it. It's fun to see, you know, Captain America against Iron Man and all of that. But what I would really not only enjoy, but, you know, champion is the growth and the development of bad guys. Like, you can't have superhero. If there were no supervillains, these guys would be pretty much out of work. They'd be pretty boring. They wouldn't have anything to do. You're as good as your best bad guy, as you saw from the second Batman movie with Heath Ledger. Like, that movie was better because the villain was fantastic. You know, he was a threat. He was somebody that you worried about. You wanted to know more about him. I would love, not only every book is focused on the hero, on the protagonist. I wish there were more books that were focused on the antagonist. I would like to see Victor Von Doom's life. I would like to see Pastepot Pete and his, like, little shenanigans throughout the city. Like, let's go in the underworld of Pastepot Pete's life and how he puts that paste together. I mean... somehow you can make that intriguing. You can make that interesting. An example of that was when Otto Octavius did take over Peter Parker's body, it was some of the most interesting Peter Parker stories ever, because you saw the potential of what Peter isn't doing with his life and what great ambition could provide you with. Because Otto, if nothing else, was an ambitious son of a bitch. He was an asshole, but he's ambitious. He had these, he gave Peter more time. He gave Peter a fucking company only because, purely through his ambition. What's going on, Derek? Welcome to the show. So I would just love to see more backstory on the heroes. I would love to see Bendis write supervillains, and not supervillains pretending to be superheroes like with Dark Avengers or anything like that. I just can't believe that bad guys are bad every day. Like, I think that there's a day where they just want to Netflix and chill. You know what I mean? Chilling, you're chilling, cool. I would like to see that. I mean, there's always this great big character development side of all the other heroes. Nonetheless, another Civil War. Art by Oliver, and I always, is it Oliver or Olivier? Copiel. It's a French name, and I butchered it, and I apologize. But some of the best artwork ever. Oh, let me talk about that. I meant to talk about that last week. But I'm going to hold this up, but I will try. I'm still messing around with iMovie, so I'm going to try to lay over images so that I'm not holding shit up like this is a fucking classroom story time. I'm still learning how to use iMovie, so let's see if I can edit and cut this in. But if not, like, This is a shot of She-Hulk defending who's the Jester in court. I mean, just look at that. That is some really great work. The colors and the inks add to it, but Copiel is one of my favorite artists, and he does the Avengers like nobody's business. She-Hulk is one of my favorite female characters, and I think that she's underutilized. Her whole Sybil-like problem with not wanting to be Jennifer Walters and wanting to be She-Hulk all the time is really dope. Violins, having a Netflix and chill. If villains thought it would be that bad. Yeah, I agree. There's some interesting things that happen in this book. For one, War Machine, Rhodey, is asked for a private meeting with the president. And it is an incredibly interesting conversation. I'm not going to ruin it for you. I think you should pick up the book. But it's an avenue that the character has never taken before. And if it prospers the way it should, it could be great. It could mean great things for that character and the growth of that character. And I never saw it going there. It's an evolved look at who this character could be. But it's a natural progression for this character for the lifetime throughout that he's been in the book, in any book. And you should really read it. He has a private meeting with the president. The president asks him something that he wants him to do for him. And it's a great take on the story. I think it's going to go extremely well. Let me see. I don't want to show you the panel, but this is him, Rhodey, in his Marines uniform talking to the president. And I think that that's a great conversation. I love where that might go. In the story, the Inhumans are a big part of it, and there's a cloud that's coming, and it's that cloud that basically, the Terrigen cloud, that if you have the Inhuman gene in you, it's going to put you into a cocoon and turn you into a superpowered person. You will be blessed, according to, you know, the Inhumans saga. If you don't know anything about it, watch some of the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and they'll probably enlighten you to things. As you know, Captain Marvel, Carol Danvers, is running a segment of S.H.I.E.L.D. now. And at one point, she asked Doc Samson for advice. And they have an interesting conversation about just her mental state and how she feels and what's next. Again, it feels as though a lot's happened prior to this book, and I haven't been reading The Avengers, so I'm playing catch-up mode with all of you. But for if nothing else, the book, it just looks great. Here's She-Hulk talking to Maria Hill on the Triskelion. And just see how beautiful she's drawn. And that's another thing about She-Hulk that I always loved. And I can't believe that she's not really more prominent in the Marvel U. Hopefully she is now with A-Force and everything like that. Again, another book that I don't read. Anyway, so during there are people just waiting for this Terrigen cloud to come over them. And a couple of kids from college are eagerly awaiting it. And unbeknownst to them, they get into the cocoon. I don't think that either one of them knew it. But I don't know if I should show you the last splash page. But something devastating happens as two of them come out of their cocoon. It's a very short book, which is something I had a problem with the Rebirth books, which is what we're going to cover in a second. Very, very short. Like, lots of ads. The book is $3.99. No, this book was $4.99. I can't tell you how fucking pissed off I am about how expensive comic books are. I used to buy comic books this is going to date me like a motherfucker, but comic books used to be 35 cents. When I started buying comic books in the late 70s, early 80s, comic books were 35 cents. Believe it or not, 35, 50 cents, 75. I remember bitching about 75. Ooh, $75. Oh my goodness. Anyway, so that's $4.99. Lots of ad. Yeah, shut up. Yes, damn, exactly. Anyway, so very, it's a good book. It's a good start. It's a Civil War Zero. I probably won't buy the individual issues of that. I have a lot of catching up to do. I'd rather do my catching up in my trade paperbacks, but I wanted to get a brief synopsis as to what's going on. If Copiel is the one drawing it and Bendis is the one writing it throughout the series, you got me, because those guys, I love the stuff that they did on Thor. I love the stuff that they did on Young Avengers. Or at least Copiel, and he's got me with whatever book he does. He's like J. Scott Campbell to me. He's, you know, Matsuda, Humberto Ramos. I will buy anything that those guys do. But let's get into Rebirth, DC's Rebirth. I got three of the new number one books, and as you know, Rebirth is basically, or maybe you don't know, Rebirth is the restart of the DC universe. Not the restart necessarily. It gets convoluted. They're missing 10 years. Somebody took it. I was talking about this last week when I was talking about the Rebirth book that Geoff Johns wrote. So basically, our DC universe never went anywhere. It was actually a third party that implemented his or her will over something that took 10 years away from the history that is the DC universe. So the reason for characters disappearing or the merging of universes or origins changing or only the Black Kid Flash and not the Wally West Kid Flash is because somebody stepped in and imbued their powers into the history of the universe to take something away from the heroes. And now, Wally West last week in the Rebirth comic has come back and he's now warning us that there's something wrong and that we should be aware of it. So anyway, Green Arrow number one in Rebirth, and I gotta say, all of the Rebirth covers look like this, and these covers look fucking shitty. These are terrible looking covers. I gotta say, these covers are ugly. You're gonna relaunch the start of your shit, and these covers, well, the Batman's not that bad, but pretty shitty. Anyway, so Rebirth number one for Green Arrow is basically Green Arrow kind of meeting Dinah Lance for the first time, Black Canary. And he is discovering that many of the homeless population in Seattle are disappearing. And I have to say, this one was done by Benjamin Percy for a story, and Otto Schmidt, a guy who I've been following online on DeviantArt, on Instagram, anywhere that I could see his art, Pinterest. If you're not following Otto Schmidt, you should. He is an incredible artist, and he does the pencils in this, and Nate Picos does the lettering. Oh, I thought he was going to be the anchor. I'm sorry. Lettering. So, anyway. Splash page intro of him. The artwork is great. They bring back the goatee, which I'm a big fan of. I've always been a big Green Lantern fan of. And he runs into Black Canary as he's trying to protect a kid he thinks is going to be one of the new, another kid that's been disappearing. So men, women, and children homeless people have been disappearing. The kid tells him that his mother just recently was one of the people that disappeared and that the underground people took her. So this starts an investigation between Black Canary and Green Arrow. Now, they haven't met. They've met briefly but never really spoke to one another. Now, here's what I have a problem with. The dialogue feels very forced. She's got an issue with him being a rich boy, trying to be a vigilante of the streets, and she doesn't believe in him, and she's from the situations that they're trying to save these kids from. And he's saying, you don't know how much money is necessary for me to even help fund and carry on what I'm doing to save these people. So they're going, you know, this whole, Hepburn and Tracy. That's probably, what is it? Tracy? Anyway, banter, back and forth. I think I'm saying it right. I can't remember it at the moment. But they're going back and forth about their judgments on one another, her being in a rock band, him being a wealthy guy, and who's right, who's coming from a standard of the best, big-hearted selflessness, and in essence, they're both doing the same thing, but the dialogue feels very forced, and I'm not a big fan of this Benjamin Percy guy. He's using a lot of big words,
And it feels like he needs to, and listen, this is just my opinion. You know, if you may love it. Benjamin Percy's probably a great writer on other books and stuff. This is just my opinion, so don't get mad at me. I just didn't, it didn't embrace me. The writing didn't embrace me. The artwork is beautiful. I have to say that the artwork by Otto Schmidt looks amazing. The book looks great. If for nothing else, just buy it for that. But I found that the writing seemed contrived and weak. And again, lots of ads. I'm like, this book is $3.99. I would say a third of the book is ads. The story is mad short. Like, I read this book in under 3 minutes. Like, it was, I mean, I don't know how long a comic is supposed to last, but this book, I was like, I'm done? What the fuck? Lots of ads. And for $2.99, I'm just like, why am I paying $2.99 if you have so many ads in here? Anyway, good book. If you're a fan of Green Lantern, it may develop into something. The artwork, if nothing else, is worth buying it for. The writing was kind of weak. Not the best. Superman, Rebirth, number one. Cover, ugly. Very ugly. Anyway, so this is after the events in the end of Superman 52. As you know, that Superman died. This is not the Superman that we know. This is a Superman from an alternate universe that married Lois and had a young son. And he came here and he was trying to help our Superman defeat, again, I'm catching up. I don't know the entire storyline, but apparently there was another Superman that lost his mind, and he and the Superman that died stopped him. Unfortunately, our Superman died in the process, and this Superman was left behind. Now, he believes, as the book opens, that very similar to his experience on his world fighting Doomsday, that he came back, that our Superman will come back. And so he's waiting outside the tomb to gather his remains. This is the Superman from the alternate Earth. He's got like a beard. He's a very nice guy. When he gets there, Lana Lang is already there because she's trying to, again, I don't want to ruin too much of the story, but she's trying to do something for Clark. This is what the new Superman looks like. Well, that Superman. I'm sure the beard will go eventually. So Lana Lang is like, he says that he's on his planet, in his Fortress of Solitude, he came back to life. But he doesn't believe that that's possible here because he's unaware that this Superman had a Fortress of Solitude. Lana does know that he had a Fortress of Solitude and knows where it is and says that the only way I'll tell you is if you take me along, because now we're partners. So anyway, he tells her of his experience with Doomsday and being afraid for the first time in his life, yet, you know, realizing that Doomsday was just a mindless monster of destruction, and it focused him a little bit more on what his goals were. When they get to the Fortress of Solitude, they trigger a recording that was meant for Kara, Supergirl, in the event of Superman's death. Upon this, and I'm not sure why he says this, but he says that he can't, that Superman is never coming back to life. You guys don't have the same elements that he had on his planet to bring you back. The regenerated matrix or some crap. What was it called? Search for regeneration matrix. And the robots there say that there is no regeneration matrix, so fuck you, you can't have it. And he tells Lana, I'm sorry, but we can't bring your Clark back. He's dead for good. So then that's really it. Because the story is so fucking short. It's him waiting outside the tomb, Lana showing up. He tells about Doomsday. They go to the fortress. He says, I can't save him. That's the whole story. And I'm cutting you short from a little odds and ends here and there. But lots of ads, extremely short book. Rebirth number one. If you guys want to be up on the Rebirth stuff, I recommend you buy these things. But in all honesty, if the stories are going to be that short, I'll just wait for the trade paperback and read six issues in one sitting, because for $2.99, it doesn't make sense for me to fucking buy these books individually. So that's done. Superman, Rebirth. So we're moving on to Batman, Rebirth number one. And again, I'm sorry, I told you these things were going to be short, but Batman is just as short. Turns out he's fighting against the Calendar Man, and the Calendar Man has some sort of a machine that's going to make seasons go daily rather than monthly. I'm going to quickly run through this because I only got about a minute and a half left on the podcast here. But so Batman has has recruited Duke Thomas, I think his last name is, the kid that's rolling as one of the Robins in the Robin book, and he's training him for something else, not as a Robin, but he gives him a suit that's very similar to Batman's suit. And he's training him for something. They're very vague about this here. Batman is focusing on trying to catch the Calendar Man and stop the machine before it goes back to spring in 3 days and will release spores that will kill everybody in the city. The artwork is great. I mean, there's really not much to this story. Again, it's very much that. Scott Snyder and Tom King do the writing, and Mikhail Janning does the artwork, which is fairly decent. It's a really solid-looking book, and I'm really interested in finding out what he's doing with Duke Thomas, or Thompson, whatever the fuck his name is. But I'm going to lose my podcast, so I'm going to end the podcast there. Thank you guys for stopping by on the podcast. I will be back next week. Peace. Podcast is stopped. I didn't want to rush through it entirely. So, what else is there? So, this is the suit that I'm talking about that he offers Duke. He's saying he's trying something different. He's not trying to start up another Robin thing. He's very vague. He doesn't tell you what it is that he's trying to do. Before you know it, after you get through all the motherfucking ads, they find out that the Calendar Man, and I didn't know this about the Calendar Man, but the Calendar Man comes back every time he dies or after the seasons change as another person. He has all of the memories of the former Calendar Man, but he's an entirely different person, DNA-wise. So as they're talking, he's training Duke like he would a Robin. There's a scene here that Alfred throws an avocado down into the Batcave that I just don't get. Maybe it'll be explained later, but it's very vague. The whole book is very, very vague and very, very short. But, you know, I'm a Batman fan, so it's going to be hard for me to hate anything. He says that Duke can live at the mansion until his parents are cured. I'm not sure what happened to his parents. I'm guessing from the image that they show that they were infected somehow by the Joker virus. I have missed out on a lot. I'm sure I can find out if I look hard enough. But that's it. I told you it was going to be a really short thing. These books go by super fast. There's not a lot to them. For some reason, as a kid, I always remembered that comics would last a little bit longer. I don't need that anymore. Let's see. Before you go, who wants to hear about my thoughts on X-Men Apocalypse? They're not good thoughts, so I don't know. If you're a big fan of Bryan Singer and X-Men Apocalypse and that, you may not want to hear me and my opinions about the movie. Anyway, so here we go. X-Men Apocalypse, my brief review of the film. The good news is that Bryan Singer says that this may be his last one. I've never liked Bryan Singer on this project. I am a fan of Bryan Singer to a degree. I liked At Pupil. That's about it. I didn't think he did a terrible job with the X-Men, but this is not the X-Men that I ever wanted and or ever considered. I thought he butchered, what was it? Past and Future. What is it? X-Men? The one that he just did prior to this one. Days of Futures Past. One of my favorite story arcs with the X-Men. I think that when you change a lot of stuff needlessly, that you disrespect the value that it has to the people that love it. And I saw that in the very first movie with the casting of, and it's minuscule things like the casting of Hugh Jackman or Famke Janssen or the original X-Men not being Cyclops, Marvel Girl, Beast, Iceman, and Angel. Those things are very important to fans like me. So constantly I've had to adjust. Okay, well, you know, you got to do this for the movie and blah, blah, blah. And now this has to change and that has to change. But in the last movie, now Wolverine's coming back in time and it's not Kitty Pryde and all these other little things are changing, and nothing seems like any backstory or any character development has truly been done. They're just cramming all of this crap into a 2-hour movie that they know people are going to go see. It might as well be a Michael Bay film. And if you know me, you know how I feel about Michael Bay. In this film, it's more of the same, and all of it, all it is now, all, it feels like the Twilight movies, because basically it's just a machine, and it's just moving, and it's like, let's move into new characters. Oh, let's go back in time to start it all over again, so we can start young actors, and we can get a brand new trilogy going, and it just feels soulless. And this story felt just as soulless, from Psylocke being in the movie for no goddamn apparent reason, to Apocalypse actually was the most developed part of the movie. I think I thought that everything was forced, like even to the way Charles lost his hair. And I'm not going to say too much, because if you haven't seen it, you should go see it. It's a summer movie. If you're an X-Men fan, you'll still enjoy it. But as a lover of the X-Men and its history, and I, you know, from being a little kid and identifying with these guys, I think that Bryan Singer has always been the wrong person to handle these characters. He's admittedly not a comic book guy. He's admittedly not an X-Men fan, and he's made the movie that he wanted to make. And I'm sure that the studio had a lot of hands in it, and it feels that way. And so for that, I've never been truly in love with them. And the wire work and the action feel 10 years old in this movie as well. When you see Wolverine, and I'm not ruining anything because they have it in the trailer that Wolverine's in the fucking movie, this could have been an epic scene. This could have been like the first time translated to film, literally, that he escapes the Weapon X project. Your first time, you know, subsequently that you see Wolverine or know of his existence. And in the books, I know how heavy it is to us as readers. And in the movie, it felt comical. The headgear, the wig that was under the headgear, like it was just like. And then there was this awkward moment between him and Jean. She's 16, and Hugh Jackman's 104. It was lit poorly. It was lit like it was on a set. I just didn't enjoy it. And maybe I would have enjoyed it a little bit more if I hadn't seen Captain America: Civil War, which was done so well. But I doubt it, because I just don't like Bryan Singer on these movies, and I hope that the next guy that they bring on really embraces the characters and goes back to the lore of you know, who they actually are, and not this garbage that you know, lineage that they've created. And I hope it's not somebody like, you know, one of the Fast and Furious directors, because that's not what's necessary either. You need people that, like the Russo brothers, that give a fuck. And I feel like I don't feel like anybody gives a fuck at these other studios. They just want to put out these movies so that they can keep the licenses. Like, and what do I mean by that? Watch the last two Spider-Man movies. Those movies are about, let's put them out in the summer, let's make some money, let's keep the license. That's how those movies feel. We don't want to lose the license. Make a movie. I don't care what it is. Fantastic Four, same thing. X-Men, they care a little bit more, but still. Do any of those movies that aren't owned by Marvel, do any of them feel like the Iron Man movies? Like, do they feel like the Captain America movies? Do they feel like the Avengers movies to a degree or so? All those movies feel like people give a fuck. Like, they are holding these licenses with value. The Fox movies and stuff, they might as well be DC movies, because they feel a lot like the Warner Brothers products. Like, they don't know what the fuck they're doing. They're just shooting shit out and hoping that it sticks to the wall. And I thought that X-Men Apocalypse was a lot like that, with a little more history and backstory, because we know these characters to a degree. But you guys have got to stop relying on Hugh Jackman to carry to make a cameo and make the movie more valid. Focus on the characters that you have. Maybe shrink the cast a little bit. Get Jennifer Lawrence out of there. She's too big for these movies. She dominates this film way too much for no reason. Why is Mystique the head of this? You know, like, we should have been developing the younger characters. We should have focused on Scott and Jean, but no, we're still trying to cram Jennifer Lawrence into this movie. The unrequited love between her and Beast is ridiculous and unnecessary. It's over. I mean, if he didn't make a play for her by the second movie, you're done. Just I'm over the whole Magneto, I'm angry thing. Actually, the whole Magneto in Poland thing I would have stayed with. I would have watched that a little bit longer because that seemed more interesting than the whole film put together. It was weak. I would give it out of 4 stars, 2.5. If you're a fan of Bryan Singer and the X-Men movies as a whole, go see it. You'll have fun because it's more of the same shit. I'm done with it, though. I'm glad Bryan Singer's done. But that's it. That's my review. It's weak. What's going on, Anthony? Disco, what's going on, buddy? Thanks for stopping by the show. I'm almost done with it, though. We reviewed Batman. What's going on, dude? We reviewed Batman, Green Lantern, and Superman from Rebirth, and we reviewed Civil War Zero. I'll be back next week I've been on for a little while now. I've been on for like 40 minutes. I'll be back next week. I don't know if it'll be comic books or a movie review or maybe even I got some toys in the mail, so maybe it'll be an unboxing. Who knows with these shows? It doesn't matter. It's all nerd. Go check me out over on TheRealEdJohnsonPresents.com. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Twitter. I'm on Facebook. I'm everywhere. Just search Ed Johnson Presents. You'll find me somewhere. But my hub is TheRealEdJohnsonPresents.com. You can find everything that I do there. This show is brought to you by Amazon, Sideshow Collectibles, Superhero Stuff, Entertainment Earth, the NBA Store, which has got a promotion that I have not posted yet. I am so sorry. Fucking final started too. I have to start put these new ads up. It gives you discounts on Cavalier and Golden State Warrior jerseys. That'll be up before the end of the day. And you can always advertise on my site for as little as $5 through Fiverr. Just go to my site, The Real Ed Johnson Presents. Along the right side, you can hit any of those ads there and get discounts on any of the brands that I mentioned. I'll see you guys next week. Peace.